Assalamualaikum. Welcome all to Easy Humanity channel. In this video I discuss the blood supply of growing typical long bone and adult typical long bone. In first part of the video I discuss the blood supply of growing typical long bone, and in the later part of the video I discuss the blood supply of adult typical long bone. The blood supply of growing typical long bone. The typical long bone has following growing typical long bone has following parts. This part is epiphysis, bony part, epiphyseal cartilage, hyaline cartilage. This is diaphysis. The part of the diaphysis near the epiphyseal cartilage is known as the metaphysis. This is metaphysis. So all parts are bony except the epiphyseal cartilage, which is formed by the hyaline cartilage. The epiphysis is supplied by the epiphyseal artery. Diaphysis is supplied by the nutrient artery, and the metaphysis is supplied by the metaphyseal artery. And the peristem covers the whole bone except the articular surfaces. So these are the location of periosteal artery. This is epiphyseal artery. One of the branch of the epiphyseal artery also enter within the metaphysis. So metaphysis is supplied by the branches of nutrient artery, metaphyseal artery, and branches arises from the epiphyseal artery. So metaphysis is the very vascular portions of growing typical long bone. Nutrient artery. Nutrient artery is a single large tortuous and accompanied by one or two veins. When nutrient artery pass through the nutrient filaments, it never give branches. The tortuosity of the artery before entrance into the foramen prevents it from being damaged and from the changes in blood pressure during active muscular contraction. The direction of the nutrient foramen is always away from the growing end. This is the humerus. The upper end of the humerus is the growing end. So the direction of the nutrient foramen is downwards. When nutrient artery enter within the medullary cavity, it divided into two branch, the ascending branch and descending branch. The ascending branch near the metaphysis give off the loop-like, hairpin-like branches, and these branches is united by the metaphyseal artery and also periosteal artery, and also branches from the epiphyseal artery. Within the medullary cavity, the ascending and descending branch, also known as the endosteal artery, and it's give off the circumferential branches, and from the circumferential branches the centripetal and centrifugal branches arises, and these branches is supply the inner two-thirds of the complete bone of the diaphysis. This is the branches of the nutrient artery, and it passes through the Brockmann's canal, and here it also gives longitudinal branches which occupy within the Habertian canal, and ultimately it anastomoses with the peristeal artery. The clinical importance of the nutrient vessels. The hematogenous osteomyelitis is usually caused by the bacteria and most commonly affect rapidly growing long bone. The blood flow in the capillary sinusoid loop region is sluggish and turbulent because near the metaphysis it's from the U-shaped lobe. So here the blood flow is low in this region, and here phagocytic function is suboptimal. So these two points facilitate deposition of organism into the metaphyseal tissue. Peristeal vessels. The role of the pedestal vessel has not been clearly defined. Pedestal system originate mainly from the surrounding muscle and provide the blood supply of the outer one-third of the complete bone of the diaphysis. So this is the articular surface. So in these two regions, peristium is absent, but rest of the portion peristium is present. So peristium has two layer, the outer fibrovascular layer, here peristial artery is present, and inner cellular layer. So this is outer fibrovascular layer, here arteries are present, and this is osteogenic layer or cellular layer. So peristial artery is inter within the compact bone by using Bachman's canal, and here also it also give longitudinal branches which occupy within the Habertian canal, and it ultimately unite with the branches of Nitrian artery. So the peristial artery is supply outer one-third of the compact bone, and Nitrian artery supply the inner two-third of the compact bone of the diaphysis, and these two vessel is anastomosis with each other. If the Nitrian artery is occlude in any region, the peristial artery can successfully give nutritional supply to the bone. So this picture showing the blood supply of the compact bone. The inner two-third is supplied by the Nitrian artery, and outer one-third is supplied by the peristial artery. Epiphyseal artery are derived from the periarticular vascular arcade. They are present in only those bones where the capsular ligament is attached to the epiphysis instead of metaphysis. In children, the epiphyseal artery is separate from the metaphyseal artery due to the presence of epiphyseal plate. Epiphysis has opening. The epiphyseal vessels are the sole source of the nutrition for the growing cartilage, and therefore they are essential for skeletal growth. So this is epiphyseal artery. It enters within the epiphysis. This is the growth plate or epiphyseal cartilage, and here one of the branch of the epiphyseal artery is entered within the metaphysis, but the branches of the epiphyseal artery and branches of the metaphyseal artery is never anastomosis due to the presence of the epiphyseal plate. The epiphyseal artery and the metaphyseal artery both give nutritional supply to the epiphyseal cartilage or growth plate. The cartilage is avascular, but by process of diffusion it gets nutrition from the nearby source. So this is the epiphyseal cartilage or growth plate. This is another epiphyseal cartilage or growth plate. The epiphyseal cartilage has different zone. This is the reserve zone. Here known mitotic activity is observed. Here this is the proliferative zone. Here chondrocyte increase their number by the process of mitosis. Here the size of the chondrocyte is increased. Here the size of the chondrocyte is hypertrophy, and the matrix is become calcified. So it get less nutrition and ultimately die and leave a empty space. So empty space, bones, empty space, bones, empty space, bones. So this is the epiphyseal artery. So epiphyseal artery is give supply to the reserve zone, proliferative zone, the maturation zones, and hypertrophy zone. And the this region where the empty space is left due to the death of the chondrocyte, this area is supplied by the metaphyseal vessels. Metaphyseal artery or just the epiphyseal artery. There are numerous small vessels derived from the arterial anastomosis around the joint. They pass through the numerous vascular foramina along the line of attachment of the capsular ligament to the metaphysis. Metaphyseal artery or just epiphyseal artery supply metaphysis and epiphysis and the articular capsule. It supplies the superficial layer of the cortex and connects with the nutrient arterial system. In the event of obstruction of the nutrient artery, peristyle artery are capable of meeting the need of both system. Epiphyseal and metaphyseal artery supply the richer than the diaphysis system. Epiphyseal and metaphyseal artery enter the both sides of the growth cartilage and they are rarely anastomosis. So this is the peristyle artery. It passes through the Brockmann's canal. Here it skips longitudinal branches which occupy within the Habertian canal. It's again communicate with the another Brockmann's canal, and here it also gives longitudinal branches. Like this, it ultimately is anastomosis with the branches of the nutrient artery. Branches of the nutrient artery also is enter the Brockmann's canal and give longitudinal branches. And here the blood vessels are very thin endothelium with very thin layer of supporting connective tissue. This is the speciality of the blood vessel present within the bone. The blood supply of adult long bone. Here the epiphyseal cartilage is absent, so the metaphyseal artery is anastomosis with the epiphyseal artery. But in growing long bone, the epiphyseal artery is never anastomosis with the metaphyseal artery. So this is chemically important. In young children, the metaphysis is the place where the hematogenous osteomyelitis is occur, and the epiphysis is the common place for adult for osteogenic osteomyelitis, hematogenous osteomyelitis. So in case children, and the metaphysis is the site of hematogenous osteomyelitis, and in case adult, the epiphysis is the site where hematogenous osteomyelitis is occur. So this is all about blood supply of the growing long bone and blood supply of adult long bone. You see here the epiphyseal artery is not communicate with the metaphyseal artery due to the presence of the growth plate. Here there is no growth plate, so epiphyseal artery is freely communicate with the metaphyseal artery. So this is all of the blood supply of typical long bone. If you like this video, please press the like button and subscribe my channel.